Computer running slow? Has your machine somehow acquired a life of its own?
It's alive!
Or do you simply desire a deeper and more meaningful connection? Be one with your operating system. It's Arizona's computer guru, Mike Swanson, and his show starts now. Listen in, chat in, and watch live streaming at guruShow.com. Want your voice to be heard? Call in with your questions and riddles. The number is 520-790-2040. This is the Computer Guru Show on AM 1030. KVOI, The Voice.
Hello and welcome to the Computer Guru Show. My name is Mike, here to deal with your technology needs and treat you like a person in the process. 790-2040. If you want to be part of the show, that's 520-790-2040. And we will solve your problems. That's what we do.
It's the triumphant return of Mike's sidekicks this week.
Yeah. Well, yeah, last week was interesting. Frustrating to a certain extent, but interesting. I think that we handled it as well as we could.
I thought it was a good show. I listened to it, of course.
And then we did an hour on his show, on Charles' show. And I think that we wrapped it up pretty well over there.
It looked like some people still had some questions about net neutrality, though. Maybe they were incited by that discussion. So you guys should call in today. Ask us about that.
Yeah. I mean, the long and short of it for me, like if I were to try to boil it down into, if I had that, you know, if I'm asked, why do you think that net neutrality is a positive thing? And I will say that, yes, even though it is government that is involved in the process of net neutrality, it is one section of the government telling the other sections of the government, stop messing with the internet. And that's the only reason I thought that was worth, having that conversation.
Yeah, you know, there's only a couple topics in the whole spectrum of things that we talk about where I, as you would say, deal in absolutes, and those are strong encryption and net neutrality. And on both of those subjects, I feel like you either agree with them or you're wrong.
Well, especially on the encryption one.
Yeah.
I mean, there is some gray area. I don't think that there's, with the net neutrality stuff, there's definitely room for improvement. Whereas both sides have at least the right intentions in mind, I think, at least with the people who are believing it. But it's the lawmakers that are the ones that I think are deceiving people.
I think that the best thing that we could do for net neutrality is just have people be more educated on the subject on both sides.
I'm with you. I'm down.
It's like scary how many people don't understand net neutrality.
Yeah, and the encryption debate, of course.
Net neutrality is really complex, though. Even every now and then I hear an argument and I'm like, maybe I don't understand net neutrality. And then I go on a binge of watching videos for like an hour. And I'm like, oh, no, I got it.
Yeah. Yeah, I still understand.
Yep.
We're good. Yeah, I'm not wrong as much as I thought I was. I mean, there's a certain amount of wrong on either side, though. Yeah, there's and I understand the point. And that's why I've tried so hard with Charles to be like, come on, dude. Just look at it. Look at it like this, just for a minute.
It is good though to have dissenting opinions, you know, especially on this show because we're almost literally an echo chamber in here. You know, we kind of all agree with each
other.
Might
not be. They got the little sound dampeners up in there.
But you know, so it's good to hear from listeners and other guests who don't necessarily agree with us every now and then.
Right. I agree. All right. So to the people who have put together the show notes, where are we going? What's going on?
Where are we going?
Where are we?
We got a lot of stuff going on.
There is a lot of stuff. I mean, I have the list now, but I'm thinking, where do you want to go?
I really want to just ignore this Kanye West thing.
With Ikea.
All right, well, now that you brought it up, now we have to talk about it.
Yeah, I know. Kanye West is obnoxious. Their story ended.
Well, imagine how he's going to be in 2020, right? Because he's running for president in 2020, isn't he?
Hopefully he's going to be not relevant in 2020.
Didn't he already announce his candidacy for president?
You know, though, if he loses, he's going to interrupt the inauguration speech and be like, I'm going to let you finish, but I was the best presidential candidate of all time.
Yeah, Kanye he's an interesting, if anything, if you follow Kanye West on Twitter, which I don't recommend really, I would say that if you're really bored and you just want to see the manifestation of crazy and virtually unlimited funds, to see what that looks like, that's
and a little bit of megalomania.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's sort of the dude is crazy.
Well, we, you know,
in my opinion,
the reason we're even mentioning him in the first place is because he's now demanding that Apple buys the failed Tidal platform.
All right, so Kanye and a few others decided to put together a music platform to effectively compete with the iTunes Store and a few other streaming music services that are out there. And it was a disaster. I don't think that there's any way to put it otherwise. That it was just a unmitigated disaster as far as... I think even the premise was flawed to be able to say, well, we're going to get all these artists and they're going to exclusively run on Tidal and nowhere else. And it's going to be, you know, super high definition sound. So you're looking at like FLAC audio, and it's going to be really expensive.
I think other than the price, I think the problems with that premise were, one, that's a really hard sell to the artists when the platform is just starting, even though it's backed by Kanye West and Jay-Z.
Right.
And then the other thing is that I think they learned that almost nobody cares about super high-definition FLAC audio.
Right. People just want to be able to act. They are falling into the same trap that the other music platforms are having, and as well as the movie industry. Whereas they are going against the idea that people just want to be able to watch or listen to whatever they want at that moment without any other issue.
People will watch downloaded movies that were recorded in the theater where you can hear people talking and there's people walking in front of the screen. Quality's not the issue.
I don't even know what FLAC audio is.
I'm not an audiophile. I mean, I do like when stuff sounds nice as opposed to like it was recorded in a tin can.
Right.
But I don't need to know about all that super high bitrate stuff.
So FLAC audio is lossless audio, meaning that there's no compression loss.
Not for Kanye West.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so lossless audio and a lossful video or a business platform.
Yeah.
It's just, I couldn't imagine saying, okay, I'm going to take my entire music catalog offline, the one that's paying all of my bills right now, and going over to Tidal and saying, well, let's just hope this works.
And now that he's recognized that it's failing, he's trying to pretend like he was behind Apple buying it the whole time. And he's saying, like, come on, guys, this fight isn't good for the fans. You know, Apple, just buy it. You know you want to.
Right.
And it's like, how are you going to try to take the high road when you literally built the low one? I don't understand.
Yeah, I like the flip on that rather than please, Apple, can you save me? It's oh, man, stop being a jerk about this and just give me the money. Just so wrong.
Like I said, you know, he's got moxie. Give him that.
He is virtually the definition of moxie.
IKEA doesn't care if Kanye has moxie or not.
Yeah, what is the IKEA tie-in on this?
So Kanye tweeted, super inspired by my visit to IKEA today, right?
Right.
And he's been putting out all these little doodles of furniture that he'd like to build.
Oh yeah, you wanted to be a designer, right? Okay.
And so they tweeted back, "Hey Kanye, we'd love to see what you'd create. We could make you famous."
That's great.
And so now everybody who has any type of paint or Photoshop skill is coming out with all this furniture design stuff, like the Kardash designed by Kanye West, and it's a chair with two butt areas.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it's great.
You know, I really feel like Kanye West is the result of parents who tell their kids that they can literally be anything that they want, and then he never learned that that's not entirely plausible.
Yeah, that it was more sort of a metaphor.
Yeah.
It was a...
Or there's this picture frame called the Kanye Frame, or Kanye Framye, basically. This picture frame doesn't require your photo. It comes with Kanye's portrait and autograph on each side.
That's awesome.
Oh, boy.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's an interesting dude. There was basically a scene on Last Week Tonight that was all about Kanye and his out there ideas. And if you find that on YouTube, you should probably watch it because it is really funny. He's really out there.
To be fair, though, I mean, IKEA is pretty inspiring. It always inspires me to eat some Swedish meatballs.
Here's the mirror Yeezy. Comes with a mirror sticker of Kanye's face that you can't take off.
Nice. Yeah, it's he's out there. And that's I also understand that to a certain extent it's those types of personalities that are required in order to, you know, become what he has become, other than the crazy part.
Right.
You know, the as far as you don't get anywhere in life if you're sort of, you know,
mundane and you don't
meek
stand out.
And you're willing to just be like, okay, this is the way the world actually works.
He's definitely confident. I'll give him that.
I still expect him to pull his mask off and it's just been Sacha Baron Cohen this whole time. That would make a lot more sense.
Wolves, man. How do they work? Anyway, let's take a moment to talk about our sponsor. Our sponsor would be Perfection Auto Works. You can check out their very new website at perfectionautoworks.com.
It's totally Kanye West free.
Yeah, there is no Kanye on the Perfection Auto Works website. At least, I hope not.
No, I don't think so.
Mike, if there's any Kanye on your website, we're going to have a talk. Anyway, check out their website. Make sure that you give them a call. Their ad is coming up next right here on the Computer Guru Show. And we'll be back after these messages.
Your computer guru, Mike Swanson, is here to help you tame that beast of a machine. Join the chat right now at guruShow.com or call in. This is the Computer Guru Show on KVOY, The Voice. Your technology guru, Mike Swanson, is answering all your questions one by one.
Yes, science!
So chime in with yours. The website is guruShow.com. Tune in, click in, and kick back. This is the Computer Guru Show.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show. My name is Mike, here to deal with your technology needs and treat you like a person in the process. This is actually an interesting story about the... All right, hold on, I got to get the headline, just because I want to make sure I get it right. Sheriff raids house to find anonymous blogger who called him corrupt.
Somebody said something about me on the internet.
Yeah. Does the sheriff not realize that you have a protected First Amendment right to anonymity?
Proving his point, man. You're proving it when you raid his house.
Oh, goodness.
So basically, corrupt sheriff proves he's corrupt.
Right. In other news, corrupt sheriff looks for a person who called him corrupt while proving he's corrupt.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, so this is in Louisiana, looks like, because they're mentioning parishes, because that's the only place I know in the United States that has parishes. Is there any others?
South. That's all I know.
That's all you know is it's somewhere in the South. Okay. So basically, it's in Terrebonne Parish in Louisiana.
Okay.
Anyway, they sent six deputies in to raid a police officer's home and seize computers and other electronic devices. So the person that
was a cop
was leaking information was a cop on a site called Exposedat. Exposedat.
That's a great domain.
Yeah, it's a blog, and basically they obtained search warrants to seize evidence, and went in there and snatched up all the stuff. Now the officer says, "No, it's not me. I'm not the one doing this," but it looks like he probably is. I don't think that's. What are they going to do? They're going to go into court and say, "Well, he was saying bad things about me." You know,
he was mean on the internet.
Right.
I guess they could probably go for, like, defamation of character or something.
I'm pretty sure, though, that when you're a public figure, there's not really a case for that.
You lose protection, you know, for your... Yeah. Once you become a public figure, you have less protection.
And a sheriff is an elected office, so...
Yeah. I believe that he would qualify as... Well, not to mention, that's also the police organization. So the police organization... virtually has no protection from slander.
It's also only slander if it's not true.
And if it causes them to, you know, like, lose money on what they do.
They can just up traffic stops for a week.
They're going to be like, oh, we couldn't stop people because we were afraid people would call us names.
It's mental anguish.
Yeah, I don't think that qualifies.
This guy needs to get over his fear and buy an Xbox.
It's terrible, all right? kicking in a door just for to avenge your name?
With six people.
Well, that's true. I mean,
that's a little bit over the top.
I'm pretty sure there were guns involved.
Probably. Yeah, I mean, it's a good thing that that guy didn't slip and fall on some bullets or something.
Oh, no, he doesn't work for the Hillary campaign.
There's so much that can be said right there, but I don't want to. Listen to all these comments that I'm not making. Yeah. I'm not going to touch that.
All right, so we're going to move right along then.
I want to live.
Anyway, there was a post on the blog that was titled, "You Scratch Mine, I'll Scratch Yours." Also, so many comments not to say. Mm-hmm. The blog calls attention to public records that the sheriff gave a parish contract despite the fact that his wife manages the office. So there was a conflict of interest. It's all kinds of little things. It's, you know, it's just proving corruption. Mm-hmm. And I think that if you're thin-skinned enough and you have to go kick in doors to stop people from telling the truth about you, then, you know,
I mean,
you deserve what you get.
Especially considering that he stopped nothing, and now he's a, you know, this is national news. And
right. As opposed to just like, oh, well, you know, nobody really cared.
Hey, sheriff guy, in case you're listening to this, you're dumb.
There you go.
I need a new door anyway, so. Come at me, bro.
Yeah, bring it, man. Bring it.
Bring it.
And that actually leads me to this. I've been watching this debate go on Twitter, where there is an intense divide between the people that feel that you should have a right to have anonymity. And you can say whatever you want, which is all, by the way, afforded to you by the First Amendment. And the other groups that are just like, nah, man, if you want to come at me, you have to put your real name on it, right? And I don't understand the argument.
I think that it would completely destroy the entire nature and purpose of the internet to require you to have your real name on there.
Well, there's a bunch of people around there that are like, I put my real name out there, why don't you?
Because that's your choice.
And that's exactly what I'm thinking. It's like, you made a choice too. You know, maybe you have less to lose than other people. And they seem to forget the people that are on the you should come at me with your real identity. That some people, because the internet is a very large place, live in places where they could be murdered for having the wrong idea or be put in prison. I mean, they could live in Germany. Or France, where if you just say something unfriendly to, you know, someone else, it can be construed as hate speech. You can be thrown in prison.
I mean, the previous story confirms why it's a valid position to not want to put your real name on the internet.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, because cops come kick your door in.
Yeah.
And, well, I mean, they still did in his case, but still. And then there was the, during the, one of the European terrorists attacks, there was somebody that was standing on a balcony that was shouting disparaging things at the terrorists that were hacking people up, and he's in jail now.
I just don't even.
Yeah, it's just like, okay, so he's saying, hey, would you stop murdering people in the name of your religion? And the government said, well, you offended him. By the way, that's the offense, is that you offended this person and now you are in jail. I'm sorry that your fifis got hurt. Really.
You know, I think the people on the ground are having more than their fifis hurt, so.
Yeah, just like. Right. It's like, this is not about your fifis. It isn't.
Excuse me, sir. Could you kindly please stop hacking my limbs off? Oh, so racist.
Right. Hey, I've never had to put up with this kind of racism before. This is terrible. I can't hardly believe this. It's wrong.
Oh, my gosh. So PC.
I respectfully disagree. I can't believe you just said that. It's craziness.
How dare you? This is wrong. I mean, the rest of the world, you guys need to get on some freedom of speech issues over here. It's just like, come on. Just let people say what they need to say. You know, I understand it may go against your agenda. May go against even, you know, the whole point is that it can go against anything. But people should be able to express themselves and say whatever they want and not be put in jail for it.
And that's the reason right there. The whole point of that was that you should be allowed to be anonymous if you want to on the internet.
Right. And you look at the things like the Snowden stuff or any of the other whistleblowing cases, you look at basically revolutions and changes in the world are started by people speaking anonymously. And the idea that your ideas can be suppressed is, to me, it's a very foreign concept.
In every other aspect of life, we have no expectation of privacy. So can we just have one place?
Revolution is exactly why they don't want free speech, though.
I understand why they don't.
Yeah.
But the other thing is that, you know, you've got, at least in the situation in Europe, mm-hmm. you've got this situation in Europe where they are technologically just bound. There are no protections for anything.
Right.
As far as being anonymous is concerned in Europe. And with the exception, which is interesting, is that they have, by European law, they have the right to online anonymity, except from the government. So it's kind of a weird setup there. But I think that Europe is going through something right now that's rather painful, right? They've got a situation over there that I don't think anybody truly knows how to deal with. And it might be a good idea that people are allowed to talk about it, because right now they're not. In fact, there are people that are being thrown in jail just for simply mentioning that they maybe feel a bit uncomfortable with the current immigration status that's going on over in Europe. And that, to me, is incredibly draconian.
Whether you agree with it or not, you know, whether you agree with the immigration status over there or not, people should be allowed to dissent.
Right. They should be able to at least have an opinion that is different than the official government line. And you should be able to say, excuse me, Merkel, what's going on over there? I think maybe you need to take a look at this.
Nope. Thrown in jail.
Somebody from Europe's going to come over here and arrest me. That's what's going to happen.
You're going to go into one of those old school dungeons with the chains on the walls. That's how I imagine jail in the
I don't think it's quite like that.
But it would be cooler, I think.
Can you believe this racism?
I know.
That's insane.
All right, 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. We're going to go ahead and take a quick break. And we'd love to. Can you just save us from ourselves? Really? That would just really help. 790-2040. We'll be right back.
Whether you're dealing with hardware installation or, heaven forbid, a virus.
No!
Mike Swanson is answering all your questions one by one. So call in or chat in with yours. The website, guruShow.com. Tune in, click in, and kick back. This is the Computer Guru Show on AM 1030 KVOY.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show. So, Rob, have we asked Microsoft for our HoloLens?
Yeah, I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon.
We should ask them. Just go ahead and throw that out
there. I'll ask.
And just be like, hey, you know, Computer Guru Show, we would love to demo a HoloLens.
They might be down.
You know what?
Surprised.
Maybe if our YouTube subscriber count goes way up.
We're getting there. Anyway, ask. I want to see if this happens.
I'll ask. All I'm saying is that I'm disappointed in you guys because there's like thousands of you out there. And we don't have thousands of subscribers yet.
Rob is disappointed. That's what's happening.
You have to make me look good, okay? You got to go subscribe so that I can be like, see that? I did that.
Yeah, because at the end of the week when I do, you know, Rob's reviews, and I'm like, Rob, look at our subscriber count. You should be doing better.
He's like, I'm sorry, but I'm not going to be able to unchain you from your desk. You have to stay locked in over the weekend.
So if you're listening to this on YouTube, go ahead and hit that little subscribe button in the bottom left of the screen and then hit the like, and that would help us.
If you're listening to this on the radio, go to youtube.com/computerguruShow and then subscribe.
Or just guruShow.com. There's a button there.
That's true.
There's lots of buttons.
We have buttons.
They need pressing.
Yes. Please press our buttons.
Plus, on the related videos for all of our stuff, you can see all kinds of cool Indian music.
Because
we have Guru in the name.
All right. Let's talk about the HoloLens for a minute.
I think that I know, you know, the story that you're going to talk about, and I think that Microsoft made a really bad move here.
Okay, so now the Microsoft HoloLens is available to the general public. If you have a little bit of discretionary income.
Right? A little bit.
A little bit.
If you're the type of person who can drop $3,000 on an entertainment device.
Right, if you can drop $3,000 on some glasses, then you can have a HoloLens. Now, I'm assuming that there's going to be plenty of people listening that just don't know what a HoloLens is.
So we've talked a lot about virtual reality headsets. Well, the HoloLens is an augmented reality headset. So you can see through it, and you can see the real world, and you can have things overlaid into your real world.
And the demo videos for this are amazing.
There's really no way we can describe it. You're going to have to just go look up a demo video of the HoloLens because it's mind-blowing.
It really is. There's every video I've seen with the, you know, the developers are actually, because they released the HoloLens to developers in March. And there's been a ton of YouTube videos that have come out from developers messing with these, with this device. And it, not to mention that even before that, there was a whole bunch of like Microsoft official sanctioned videos that they had put out doing like press tours and trade shows and stuff like that, sort of showing off the technology. But of course, you can't really trust those, right? You never know what they did in post.
Yeah, there's nothing like, you know, to me anyway, there's nothing like seeing a regular dude putting the headset on and seeing exactly what it looks like, glitches and all.
Right. And yeah, there definitely are glitches, right? This is a very new and very interesting technology. But I think it has phenomenal use, right? We talked with GearVR.
MergeVR.
MergeVR. And we talked with them, and you, my point was like, I want to see this be more useful. And that's true, right? It's good for what it does. It's entertainment device. I think that the HoloLens has the ability to be just remarkably useful.
Yeah, and I think that's the main difference, is that virtual reality headsets are entertainment platforms with utility as a secondary feature. It's the reverse with the HoloLens, in my opinion anyway.
And that's what it seems like. I mean, of course, Microsoft was showing off the entertainment side of them.
That's what they have to do for the public, I think.
But watching the videos of the developers, you get to see the real utilitarian portion of this.
I'd like to see some medical applications where, you know, a surgeon can have the HoloLens highlight all the pieces of the person's body.
Yeah.
And name them.
It would be very good. I think for education, HoloLens would be amazing.
Yeah, and I mean, you were talking about usefulness as a, you know, for driving, to augment your driving and make you a better driver.
Right. So you have heads-up displays for everything, as far as you know what's coming up ahead. Maybe it can warn you if there's an ambulance or something coming up behind you. All of these different, you know, functions, I think, are very cool. And it does all of this crazy measuring. Like, all of the developer videos I've seen so far, they're like, okay, let's fire this up. This is a new, you know, we're just trying this out for the first time. And it makes you map your environment. So it's looking at your house and, like, measuring the walls and where the furniture's at and all of this stuff. And then you can start changing your world.
Yeah, you can. The reason it does that is because you can interact with things in augmented reality. You know, if you don't like your little 43-inch TV or something, you can throw an 80-inch one on the HoloLens wall.
Right, and just map it right over the top of it, and suddenly you have a different TV in your house.
So if you think about it, I mean, maybe it is worth the $3,000.
Right, you don't have to buy an 80-inch TV. This thing's really expensive.
That's the only
that was my dilemma last week. I was like, oh, I have to buy an 80-inch TV.
Yeah, might as well get the HoloLens. There's other things that I think that'll be really interesting as the technology evolves.
So my problem with them releasing it for public purchase is mainly because I really, really, really like the HoloLens. And I think that if they make it public facing right now, the price point, because it's really high compared to even like the HTC Vive virtual reality.
Right.
The price point is going to scare people away, and then the people who do buy it, I think they're going to expect way more than they can get right now, because this is still a developing piece of technology.
Well, sort of the fate of the Google Glass.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, we saw exactly what happens with a really cool piece of technology that's released before it has, you know, too many applications.
Right. Microsoft's official, you know, stance on this is that we want more development to happen for this, so we're going to make this available so that there is more of a market and a greater push for development on this.
And I hope that, I mean, my real hope is that the $3,000 price point scares almost everyone away.
Yeah,
and they don't buy it.
Serious about it.
Because
right?
The developer is going to see it as an investment, and they're going to be like, I need this in order to make more money with it. But your average consumer, I think if they buy it, they're going to be disappointed, because there's just not, you know, it's one of those things you can put on right now and you can be entertained for a couple of days, And then you're going to be like, all right. And you'll set it down on your shelf where it collects dust.
I'd like to see more applications like, for instance, in cooking or in auto repair or something where you use the lenses and you look at a part and it tells you, for instance, what's hotter than something else.
That'd be interesting. I wonder if there is thermal capability on that.
I don't imagine it would be that hard to do.
Huh.
For $3,000, there better be thermal capability.
Yeah, well, that's sort of a, or yeah, like, the exact argument you're making.
In the case of Arizona Computer Guru, if you went on site and you were wearing them, maybe you could see, without opening up the computer, where there's more connections going on or something inside the case.
Are you implying that Mike already doesn't know literally everything the moment
he
arrives on site?
Well, I know that, but I'm just saying.
He's the guru, Tara.
It could help. I'm just saying it could assist.
I think that there's a lot of places that this could be really useful.
Mm-hmm.
Once again, we go back to like architects or interior designers, right? Because it measures the room rather precisely and it knows where everything is. And you could just say, well, what's it going to look like if I move all this stuff around? You know, and you could rearrange the room virtually and figure out how that's going to work and change the color schemes and very cool stuff, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, we already kind of have a template, though, for what is likely to happen with this. The Oculus Rift had two development kits that came out. And the first one, just it really wasn't that great. You know, it was a tech demo, and it was meant to be built upon. But lots of people were so excited about it that they bought it right away, and then they were like, this thing sucks.
Right.
And Oculus was like, yeah, bro, it's not finished. You know, it's nowhere near finished, so unless you can write code, please don't buy it.
I'm really interested to see where Microsoft goes with this, just because I do think it's very interesting.
You know, I don't think this, and it kind of scared me for a moment, but when I first saw it, I thought they were just dumping it. I thought they were just like, let's abandon the platform and make as much money as we can.
I don't think Microsoft's going to pull that.
I hope not.
Go that route. I mean, from the stuff that I've been reading about the development of the HoloLens, they're doing nothing but ramping up.
And, I mean, because it's Microsoft, I'm less inclined to believe that they would do that, because they have the money to just play around with something.
And that's true. And really, I mean, if you watch the videos, I seriously, when you do the show notes, put some links in for this, because there are the demo videos are amazing.
I mean, we're starting to see these things come into real life now that we all thought about as kids. You know, like standing in your room imagining a robot breaking through the wall and you have to shoot it with a laser beam. You can literally do that with the HoloLens.
And that's one of the demo videos, actually. There's very interesting stuff where they've got games that interact with your world. And sure, it's the stuff of nightmares if you want it to be, but it's very cool.
What I'm excited about is the stuff of nightmares. I love the horror games. So
yeah, that's where you and I, nope. Not
yeah, I mean,
doing
that's
those.
So much.
All right, let's go ahead and take another break. If you want to be part of the show, 790-2040. That's 520-790-2040. We'll be right back.
Computer troubles? Need some advice? Call in now. Mike Swanson will be back after these messages. The Computer Guru Show, AM 1030, KVOY, The Voice.
And your computer guru is just a click away. Listen and watch at guruShow.com. This is a Computer Guru Show on KVOI, The Voice.
Oh, welcome back to the Computer Guru Show. My name is Mike, here to deal with your technology needs and treat you like a person in the process. 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. So last week, we gave away a headset.
Yep, the MergeVR headset.
MergeVR headset, which for some reason, some of the internet was unhappy with us, like, offering.
I don't know. Apparently some people thought that we were trying to scam them.
Well, we weren't. We actually gave one away. And actually, he's on the phone. So let's have a talk with him. Hello, Vinko?
Hello.
Is that pronounced properly, by the way?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Just making sure. So did you get your headset?
Yeah, it arrived this morning, actually.
Nice.
Fantastic. And so thanks for participating in there. You heard about us on Vote, I assume, right?
Yes.
So for those of you who don't know, Vote is sort of like the Reddit alternative.
Better.
Better?
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because of my position in this, I will say that I'm going to remain neutral on the...
I personally was happy to hear that it was someone from Vote who won. I thought that was really cool.
Right on. So what do you think? Did you try it out yet?
I did try it out, and I was actually a little bit worrisome, because the phone that I have is the first generation Moto X, and so it's only a 5-inch screen, So I was like, I don't know if my phone's going to be big enough for, you know, doing virtual reality, because I never tried it before. So when I tried it with my phone, it actually worked perfectly. My only complaint is actually with my phone, because my phone only supports 720p. Mm. So
you see a lot of pixels.
It's still a little blurry.
Right.
But other than that, it worked perfectly.
That's awesome.
Darn it, Motorola. You got to give this guy a phone. That's what you got to do.
Hey, VR is a good reason to upgrade your phone. I did it.
Yeah, right on.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I really appreciate the fact that you signed up. I'm glad that you've gotten it. You know, please tell the other people with pitchforks on Vote that it wasn't a scam.
Uh-huh. Please enjoy it for my sake. I didn't get to try it.
Oh, poor Tara didn't get to try out the VR headset.
The gamer didn't get to try out the VR.
That's because you live so far away. You almost live as far away as Vinco here.
Oh, yeah?
Right. Hey, where are you at, Vinco? Where are you at?
New Jersey.
See? Almost as far.
Oh, come on. Jeez.
What's the future like? Is VR better in the future?
Oh, it's actually pretty bad.
It gets worse from here.
Right. So, yeah, whenever you live 3 hours in the future... Or 2 hours in the future right now, I think.
Some amount of hours in the future.
Yeah, 92 hours in the future is where New Jersey is from Arizona. And we only know this because we don't do that whole time zone change thing. We don't do that daylight saving stuff. Can't handle it. We're too stupid.
It's true.
But anyway, I'm glad you got it. Thank you very much for calling in and letting us know how it went. Are you going to send us some pictures of this of you with your device?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I could probably do that.
Yeah, we'll stick them up on the website, and, you know, you'll already have a VR headset on, so we don't have to, like, cover your eyes or anything.
I'm going
to
take the picture and just write, not a scam, on it. That's right. Well, the reason that I'm saying that is because we want to do more of these giveaways, so I want you guys to be comfortable with it.
Yeah, what else do you think that we should give away, Vinco, so that, you know, you might potentially win?
Oh, a Tesla?
Tesla? That might be a little bit out of our budget at the moment.
If we get our hands on a Tesla, that's when I leave for Mexico. That's all I'm saying. With my shiny new Tesla.
Yeah, there's no chargers.
Oh, that's true.
Darn. You have to stay in the continental U.S. if you want to be able to drive that thing.
I'll just keep driving. That's what I'll do.
If Elon Musk is listening and he wants to throw a Tesla down for the giveaway... believe me, I would be all over it. You'd have to give me two, though. One for testimonial purposes, the other to give away.
You'll have to remove me from the contest, because it'll be like, why does Rob have 6 million entries?
Well, thanks for the call, Vinco. Thank you very much for participating, and we're hoping that we're glad that you listen.
Oh, yeah, and thanks for the contest. I can't even think of the last time I won something, so that put a smile on my face.
You're a winner.
Awesome.
A winner is you.
A win-rar is you.
All right, on. Do we have to fit another break in here, or do we not? Because I always...
Okay. No, we took the
all right.
third one.
I didn't mess up the clock this week?
No, you did.
How
good job.
Weird is that?
You're all good, man.
Right on. Yeah, so if we'll work on getting the Tesla, and hopefully you can win, Vinca.
All right, great.
Thank you so much for calling in, man. That was awesome.
All right. So,
thank you.
Moving right along, while we still have a little bit of time in this particular segment, that was really nice of him.
Yeah. He mentioned before that that he, you know, was wanting to call in, so I'm glad that he did.
Right on. Where are my show notes? I lost them. Okay. Now, the Olympics. Has anybody actually watched the Olympics? I have not watched a single moment of the Olympics.
I've been watching the Kitty Olympics and Rocket League Championships. I'm not watching Rio.
How about you?
I don't care about sports. Sorry.
The Olympics is not about sports, sir.
It's literally sports.
So that would be a no.
It's literally all sports.
The Olympics is one big sport to see who gets the most medals. So.
The only reason we're bringing it up is because the Olympic committee basically said, you are not allowed to make memes or
GIFs
or any animated anything regarding the Olympics.
What? I don't think they know how the internet works.
They may have been a little too late on that anyway. Have you seen the redesigned logo with the biohazard symbol in the middle?
Did they forget what happened when Beyonce wanted a picture removed from the internet?
Streisand effect.
That's not how any of this works.
Yep.
Yeah, so if you don't know what the Streisand effect is that Beyonce picture was perfect. There is a very unflattering picture of of Beyonce out there. And it was during one of her like Super Bowl performances, I think. Mm-hmm. And she demanded that that come off the internet. And that only made that picture multiply and then become altered
it
and
still
just
gets,
get worse.
It still gets posted. And they're like, just in case you thought this was gone.
Right. Hey, Beyonce, this picture's still here. Bam.
Your only hope with the internet is to just embrace it.
Right, or just to let everybody burn out on it, just and it will out. Eventually go away.
But if you say you must take that down immediately,
oh yeah,
you done it.
You done goofed.
So now what's happened, though, is that they struck this agreement with all of the platforms to say, well, if we find any of these, we're going to report them. We want you to remove them. And apparently the, you know, like Twitter and Facebook and all of that will remove your post if it is of the Olympics. And why? Well,
like, honestly, why? What is the goal?
Yeah, what is the point of this?
Because you might offend somebody.
Or you might interest someone. And then right? You have an, I mean, what if I see, I just said I don't watch the Olympics. What if I see a GIF or something like that, a meme about the Olympics, and I'm like, wow, I should check this out.
What if North Korea finds out they didn't win all the gold medals? Okay.
That's because they won all the platinum ones, Tara.
Diamond encrusted.
I don't think they know how to.
I just the only people who would insist that something be removed from the internet are people who don't understand the internet.
So what's going on with the Olympics anyway? First of all, they're saying that they don't understand how the internet works by saying please don't. Well, not even saying please. They're just saying don't you are not allowed,
and we will remove it.
Yeah, you are not allowed to do this, and we will remove it. But they apparently don't understand like healthy living standards. You know, water pollution.
Maybe that's why they want it removed.
They don't understand what's going on with the Olympics. The Olympics this time around just seems to me like they didn't have time to plan this or what?
I'm usually kind of interested in it. I have absolutely no interest this year. None.
Well, they win the gold medal in censorship.
Yes. All right, let's see what Jeff wants to talk about. Hello, Jeff. How are you?
Hey, Mike. Doing good.
Fantastic. What can I do for you?
Hey, I got some girls who just came back. My kids just came back from a trip, and we've got pictures on their iPhones. And I've got pictures on my Android Galaxy, and I want to get them to my TV. I have an Android box on there. What is the easiest, straightforward way to mirror or cast or whatever they call it to get those pictures, all of them, up on the TV screen?
If you've already got an Android TV connected, you should be able to just use the Chromecast feature on your phone and send it directly to the TV.
Chromecast. Isn't that the little thing that you plug into the TV that you pay $35 for?
Yeah, but Google also includes most of that stuff in all of their smart TV devices nowadays.
What is your Android TV box?
It is like a one from China or whatever. Mm. So I have the Play Store app, but it does not... Some of the apps do say they're not compatible with your device.
Yeah, you can't buy the cheap ones, man. Come on.
Well, I mean, if you're willing to cough up the $35, the Chromecast is one of the most useful devices you can get, honestly.
Okay.
So is the TV a smart TV itself or no?
No.
Okay, yeah. So Chromecast, Fire TV, even the Apple TV, right? They're all about the same price. They're all lovely. I would look into one of those because those will allow you to do what you're asking for.
All right. Thanks, guys. Right,
apparently we're getting Oscar'd.
Yep. It's time to go to break. We'll see you right after these messages. To the Computer Guru Show. My name is Mike, here to deal with your technology needs and treat you like a person in the process. 790-2040 if you'd like to be part of the show, and we'll help you out with whatever technology issues you are having, because that's what we do. And I would just like to say that anything that I say on the show is my opinion, and not necessarily that of anyone else.
Are we gearing up for a rant here?
And you know why I'm saying that is because I'm just going to have to... Comcast. Let's go and talk about Comcast for a minute.
Again?
Yeah, just because they're such lovely, lovely people over at Comcast. They've decided that not only are the ridiculous data caps that they put on you not enough way to make money, nor the crazy increase they put on you every year just for your loyalty, right? Just because you're a loyal Comcast customer, because, you know, you could switch, maybe, if there was a choice.
If there wasn't a forced monopoly.
Right. You know, they've decided that Now, you may not want to be a part of their deep packet inspection. So Comcast does this thing, and I'm sure others do as well, where they do this snooping of your data packets, right? They're looking at what you're doing and where you're going, and then they tailor ads to display to you. Not only do I think that the browser hijacking that they do to do full screen announcements to you are wrong, but beyond this, they're collecting a ton of information about their user base and then tailoring ads for them. And that information, by the way, is either given or sold off to other companies for marketing purposes, which is in the fine print of the Comcast deal. Not to mention that you don't have a choice. It's either you accept this or you don't. At least historically, that's been the case. You either accept this or stop using their product.
And I mean, what are you going to do? Use CenturyLink instead?
Right. No. Also, this, everything I say is my own. Anything Rob says. but you know, Comcast, in their generosity, has decided to offer you an opt out. Right? If you can opt out of this for $30 to $50 a month, you can now have privacy.
If you want to pay for it.
Right. If you want to drop the $30 to $50.
I just want to say right now that for that same price, actually significantly less, you could sign up for a really good VPN.
Yeah, and that's what you do, by the way. If you're a Comcast customer or any customer of any ISP, and you want to make sure that your traffic is, you know, yours, nobody's taking a look at it, you find yourself a really nice VPN.
If you really want to get technical, you could also spend $35 for a Raspberry Pi and turn it into a pie hole so that no device on your network sees any of those ads anyway.
Yep. So, you know, and we should probably do a little seminar on that, little video. We'll put some on the YouTube page about how to do the pie hole.
It's awesome.
So, yeah, that's it. I'm buying another Raspberry Pi next week.
I probably need to do that.
Because Rob's never giving mine back.
It's true.
I have a lot of devices.
Do you mean my micro gaming station?
Yes, your micro gaming station.
No.
No, she's not falling for it.
But no, I mean, this whole... I just can't even when it comes to stuff like this. Comcast, what are you doing?
Yeah,
all you're doing is ensuring your own demise.
Yeah, there's a certain amount of, you know, I think that there is as with all corporations, there is a division of the company that is in control because of the money. And then there's another portion of it that's like, okay, we are the people that make up this company and we have to do this just crap. And I guess the part that bothers me the most about this is that it's underhand, it's shady. And of course, what am I thinking? It's Comcast, right? You know, it's like if you listen to those recordings of people trying to quit Comcast, you know, it's so Brokeback Mountain, right? Just, you can't quit us, right? It's just how that works. You're not allowed out. And it's, oh man, Comcast just makes me crazy.
I mean, it's the situation that they've created is win-win for them and lose-lose for you. Either
right.
You pay them a $35 fee or whatever, which is to recoup the money that they would lose selling your information, or they get to sell your information. So they're getting money either way.
And here's the deal. There's enough people that have no idea what a pie hole is or a VPN or anything like that. They're going to go ahead and pay that $30-$50.
Well, or they won't, right? And that's, to
either
me,
way,
that's
yeah.
The more dangerous thing. It's just like... I don't like the collection of data.
I mean, it's also not to mention that you're paying that $35 to the company that was, you know, going to sell your data anyway. So there's no insurance that they're...
At that point, it becomes extortion. That's right.
Unless you read every word of their 50-page user agreement, you don't know that it's not going to say in there, oh, we can do it anyway, or something to that effect.
Right, and it probably still does.
Yeah.
So. And it's not just Comcast. It's probably all of them. I know it's stores, too. Because I worked at a telemarketing place for all of 2 weeks before I quit because I could not handle it. And the way they got their... The thing that we were doing was a cruise. We were calling people for a cruise, right? Total scam. Anyway, they got their names off of people who bought travel items from places like Target and Walmart. So if they bought suitcases within the past 6 months, they were on our name list.
See, it just makes me angry.
That's just how it works.
And the good thing about all of this is that it's created this push for VPNs to be accessible and easy to use. And they are.
Right, and not to mention though the ISPs are trying like all get out to stop you from using VPNs. And luckily, the way that the internet was originally built, and the importance of VPN as far as keeping data safe, prevents them from stopping you from using VPNs. I think it's a matter of time before that we're going to have to find a new way to be safe, because they're going to find a way to either stop the VPNs or nullify them in such a way that they can still look at your traffic usage.
And that's a terrifying concept.
Well, if you want to go down the rabbit hole and be completely safe, just get off the internet. Because, I mean, Comcast's going to do Facebook, Twitter. They all collect all that kind of information. So you might as well just go analog.
Come on. Come on.
That's what I'm saying, though. There's really no way around it. So a lot of people are probably going to pay the $30 to $50.
Right. However, though, the internet is the way that it is now.
Yeah.
Right. Just look at the difference between 10 years ago and now. It's going to be like, well, you know, you don't like it, just stop breathing, drink some bleach, you're done. Right? You cannot live offline.
Oh, anymore. I know.
I will say, if you just want to try out a VPN for free, go check out Tunnel Bear. We're not even getting paid to say that. You know, they'll give you 500 megs free to test it out, and you can sign up for that or a different VPN if you want.
Tunnelbear.com?
Yep. It's pretty great.
That's BEAR?
Yeah. It's like an actual little like teddy bear.
Right. Instead of like naked.
A teddy bear that protects you from Comcast.
There you go. It's a useful little teddy bear. Yeah, I know that you were looking at the Tunnel Bear VPN, and what did you think of it?
It's awesome. I tried it out. It totally works.
Right on.
And I mean, their base paid package is only like $9 a month. So significantly less than $50 a month.
Right. And I know that a lot of people that listen to the show are concerned about privacy, and they are concerned about what information is being leaked. And it's amazing how much information we do leak, right? As far as, you know, unintentional consequences of signing up for something or using a specific browser or not using an ad blocker or even down to which choice of email provider you have.
Oh, I mean, if you're using your ISP's email, You're doing it wrong.
Yeah, doing it really wrong.
Really, really wrong.
And I tell people not to use provider email all the time, and not even just for the privacy concerns. It's just someday you might want to move, right? And you're not going to get to keep that email address unless you want to continue paying them for the end, you know, until the end of time. So stop using provider mail. And there are several options out there for secure email. We even offer one.
Honestly, I mean, that's what I did. I pay Computer Guru for my email because I bought my own domain and I hosted it with our company because that's the only way I feel safe.
Right. So if you're interested in having, you know, more secure email, give us a call. We can help you out. We can even point you in the direction. And the truth is even though like Google does snooping on content, sort of, you know, that's still better than provider mail as far as the data that's collected. So really, if you want some better options, give us a call. We can help you out with that. 304-8300 if you want to give us a call. Or you can email us radio@azcomputerguru.com. There's also a ton of ways to contact us on the websites. So you can go to azcomputerguru.com, guruShow.com, or any of our other domains that we have out there.
Plus, if you buy your own domain and host with us, you can get like some super snazzy cool domain. It doesn't have to be at gmail.com.
Right.
It can be at yournameiscool.com if
like,
you want.
Like kenttheboardoperator.com, right?
That's what I want, yeah.
I won't give mine out, of course, but I will say that every time I tell someone my email,
they're like, what?
That is awesome.
I have to admit, I like your domain. All right, so let's go ahead and take a break. And when we come back, more of your phone calls and just the insanity that is the world of technology. 790-2040. We'll be right back.
Your computer guru, Mike Swanson, is here to help you tame that beast of a machine. Join the chat right now at guruShow.com or call in. This is the Computer Guru Show on KVOY, The Voice. Mike Swanson, your computer guru, is just a click away. Listen and watch at guruShow.com. This is the Computer Guru Show.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show. My name is Mike, here to deal with your technology needs and complain about the RIAA. Give us a call, 790-2040.
Because that's what we do.
That's what we're doing now. So about once a year, I have some sort of a rant about the RIAA. And they're people that control, like, the music industry. And
you mean the Illuminati?
It's not the Illuminati.
It's confirmed.
Or is it, though?
All right. It may be. I don't know. As far as I know, it is not the Illuminati.
I'm just saying, people have seen goats go into their headquarters and then never come out again.
There are triangles in the A's.
Oh, man. Okay. So, for about a year now, the RIAA has been all over YouTube and putting out all of this information saying that that there are so many, you know, violations of copyright law, and that they're saying that the only reason that YouTube is still in business or able to operate, even though they operate at a loss every year, is because people are pirating music videos and playing them online. And this is very reminiscent of me, and this is going to show how old I am, I guess, of when the RIAA got really upset that they added a record button to tape players back in the day.
This will kill the music industry.
This is going to kill the music industry because, you know, there's going to be so many pirated copies of tapes out there. And no. It turned out that that didn't actually happen at all. As far as, at least, it did not hurt the music industry whatsoever.
It's also extremely silly to make the claim that, you know, it's because of people pirating that that's why YouTube exists. If you look up the top-rated YouTube videos of all time, they're the official...
Yeah, the Vivo ones.
Yeah, the official videos of that musician.
Right, and it's really, I find it to be disingenuous. I think the RIAA, in general, doesn't understand how the world works. Right? They think that because there are some people out there that take a song and they add the lyrics to the page or, you know, to the screen, and some people watch that, I don't think they realize how small that number is. But YouTube has a response to this. YouTube says that of the pirated or otherwise unofficial versions of music videos that are out there, makes up about 2%, composes about 2% of the total site volume as music is concerned.
People just don't realize how much video is on YouTube. It's like 100 hours every minute.
Yeah, so every minute, and I think that is the right number, every minute another 100 hours of video is added to YouTube. It's crazy.
And most of those are videos that will never be seen by anyone, of course. But I think that's the reason why people think, you know, especially like the RIAA, thinks that YouTube is just a music piracy website.
Well, it's because, you know, the RIAA sees some of that stuff that's out there, and they're intentionally looking for these types of things. I mean, YouTube has some amazing built-in tools to find this stuff and kill it immediately.
Just try to upload a music video to YouTube.
Yep.
There's about a 75% chance that it will be terminated within that day.
Yeah, and I think even higher than that.
Yeah.
I think it's well into the upper 90s.
I've had it, you know, I've tried it before just to test it out, and as soon as the video was done, it just didn't have audio.
Right. It's like, nope, you have a song in here that you should not have, and it automatically attributes any view counts to the original artist.
And honestly, YouTube's under no obligation to do that. The way that their site works, it's all user-generated content. They don't have to ensure that there's nothing copywritten on there.
Sort of. No, there is a little bit of a provision there that YouTube has to abide by U.S. copyright law.
They have to remove it if it's found, but, you know, they're under no obligation to forcibly stop people from uploading it.
Right, and that's true. And YouTube voluntarily does this. They built an algorithm that looks for anything that looks or sounds too much like something else. So it knows if you uploaded a song that belonged to someone else. It knows that already, and it will immediately kill it.
They've also provided a huge library of copyright-free music for their creators to use so that they're less inclined to use copywritten music. I mean, they've taken all these steps, so I don't really know what the RIAA is complaining about.
Right, it's one of the reasons that we have can't, you know, pick grandpa music for the bumpers.
Oh. Okay.
I'm just messing with you. Okay. Just messing with you, Kent.
He's like, you want to see old? Now we're just going to have, like, ragtime.
There's going to be some Lawrence Welk playing.
Oh, we should get some ragtime up in here.
He's giving me a look over there.
Guru one, Kent, nothing.
Get some Slim Whitman. All right. Find that.
So the whole point of this here is that the RIAA is making these claims that YouTube is being terrible, and they're trying to actually take this to court and say, well, YouTube is doing terrible things because they're allowing people to upload music videos. And the thing is that it's 2%.
You know, the other thing is that I've told a lot of people this, and this is honestly how I feel. You shouldn't be willing to present a problem unless you have a solution in mind, a feasible, actionable solution. What does the RIAA think that YouTube can do? They literally cannot prevent people from uploading this stuff.
They can't. And YouTube has already done the thing that they can do, which is to algorithmically identify music that exists already.
And it's not just YouTube. There's Vevo, and there's, you know, and Vimeo, and all these other, you know, Facebook. Every other site that allows you to upload a video has the same problem.
Right. And, well, I think that the bigger issue with the RIAA is that they are trying to strong-arm a failing business model, right? When it comes to music, right, they are convincing their creators that YouTube is why they're not making any money, rather than them coming out and just saying, well, it's because we took all of your money. They're saying, well, YouTube is really putting a damper on your income here.
I wish they would just ask the artists, because what percentage of artists nowadays were discovered through YouTube originally?
Quite a few now.
Or have people find their content through YouTube?
I think it's for me, as an example, I watch very few things, right? I don't have TV. I've complete cord cutter there. I don't pay for cable or satellite or any of that stuff. Everything that I see comes from the internet. And in many cases, and I think in a large majority of that is YouTube, you know, where I will just sort of go down the YouTube rabbit hole.
Yep.
I'll pick a video and then I'll see, well, what's recommended
just leave
next?
Autoplay on and see what happens.
And believe me, that'll take you to some dark places.
But I do have to say that, I mean, when I'm doing that at work, for instance, if I'm working and I put on some music, I'm probably 90% of the albums I've actually purchased in the last year, it was directly because of YouTube. Because I found a band on there and I was like, hey, these guys are good and they're kind of small. And go buy their album.
I don't know. It irritates me.
And, the RIAA also doesn't seem to realize that this is Google that they are messing with. I know the RIAA is a huge organization, but Google is also a huge organization.
Let me just go ahead and put this into context for people. The RIAA is the same group of people that tried to sue someone because they were pirating music for a dollar amount that is greater than all of the money that has ever existed in the history of mankind. Right? That amount of money doesn't even exist. And never has, cumulatively.
I'm pretty sure you could have built the Death Star with the amount of money that they were talking about.
Right. So, to put that into context, it's just, come on.
I mean, is Kanye West the head of public interaction at the RIAA?
It's just, that's how reasonable these people are, is that they're going to say, and literally write it down on a court document and send it out into the world to say, we want a settlement amount that is greater than the amount of money that exists.
Do you know what it is, though? It's fear, and you can smell it. They're scared of the internet because it makes organizations like theirs irrelevant.
It absolutely does. Let's go ahead and take a quick break. We will be right back right after these messages, and then we're going to take your phone calls at 790-2040. We'll be right back.
So, welcome back to the Computer Guru Show, where Mike is still at break, apparently.
An MIA.
Hey.
You're not needed, Mike. It's okay. You can go home.
We're good. Me.
This is
We're
now
good.
Rob's show, and we have a new set of rules. Ah, he's back. Darn.
What are the new rules? I want to know what the new rules are.
Only I get to speak.
Okay.
You will speak when spoken to. So now I'm speaking to you, so go on.
Okay.
Go on.
All right, let's go ahead and take some calls here. By the way, if you want to be part of the show, 520-790-2040. And let's talk to Kevin. Hello, Kevin. How are you?
Hey, thanks. Kevin here. Hi, Rob. Hi, Tara. quick question for you guys. Thanks. I'm enjoying the show today, as always. Suppose somebody listened to the show on a regular basis, and on occasion they called in to give everybody a laugh, but over the years they knew that they were supposed to update to Windows 10 by July 31st and somehow had a brain freeze and then tried to download on July 31st Windows 10, but they couldn't get it on their machine.
Uh-huh.
How would you advise them to get around not having to buy a copy of Windows 10?
Well, I mean, it would seem to me that somebody had missed the deadline, had some sort of a disability.
Absolutely right. That's true. Well, it would take a person with a disability to appreciate a person with a disability, I'm sure. But that's neither here nor there. That's a recorded conversation.
It actually is here.
Yeah, because the good thing is that if you have a disability...
Yes, I do.
You can get Windows 10 at any time.
How do you do it, Rob? What do you do?
Well, you call Microsoft and tell them you have a disability.
Okay. Seriously, do you really?
No, you'd actually don't even have to call them
right,
now.
You can just claim it.
Yep. No, if you use the Windows accessibility tools, the deadline doesn't apply to you.
Windows accessibility tools.
So like the narrator or the screen magnifying glass thing.
Okay. Oh, that's all I have to do is use it? I do use that too, though. That's a sad thing.
Well, there you go.
I mean, if you legitimately do use it, then you're not lying.
You use it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. I'm not telling anybody that they should claim to use it when they don't need it.
But
however,
if you do need it,
yes. If it happens to be on your computer,
okay,
you
all
can
right.
still
I'll make sure it's
you know,
on.
Some might say that pathological lying is a disability in and of itself.
It could be,
though. No. You won't even go there. Just to vote Democratic in the next election, then I can claim that. Stop it.
Stop it, Kevin.
Have a great day.
Stop
okay,
it.
I appreciate
hey,
it.
Hey, Kevin, before you go.
Go, Rob.
Give me a call on Monday.
I will, buddy. I promise you, man. I got back last week. I'll talk to you. I promise
sounds great.
You. I got nothing going.
I'm going to hold you to
that. And I are writing rewriting a webpage, okay?
If you don't call, I'm going to hold
know.
You.
Listen, you guys know where I live.
I'm going to call you out next week on the show.
Okay, I know you will, man. So, okay, thank you guys very much. I appreciate it.
Have a good
you.
One,
have
man.
A great day, all right?
All right,
thank you guys.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, we're working on a website for him. By the way, if you want to get your website worked on, you give us a call, 790-2040. And or at the shop, 304-8300. All right, let's move on. Next, we're going to talk to you. Which one's next? Ted? Let's talk to Ted. Hello, Ted. How are you?
Oh, how you doing, Mike?
I'm doing well.
I did a stupid thing last night. I downloaded Flash quite a while ago to use with my virtual account numbers. And somehow I deleted it. And now every time I try to upload from Adobe, it gets about 50% and then just stops.
That was kind of a roller coaster because I thought the dumb thing was downloading Flash. I'm just kidding.
All right, so which browser are you using?
I went to Adobe and I've got just Flash Player.
Right, but what browser? How do you get to the internet? Which icon do you click on?
It's for Firefox.
You're using Firefox. All right, so here's the simplest solution. Stop using Firefox. Use Chrome.
And use what?
Use Chrome.
Use Chrome. Okay.
Flash is built into Chrome.
There is a Flash player.
Its Flash support is built into Chrome.
Oh, it's already built in.
All right. So then you don't have to download that very dangerous piece of software and have it on your computer.
Well, that's why I deleted it. And then I found my virtual account numbers don't work.
All right. So
they need Flash.
Use Chrome.
Yeah. If you have a legitimate need for Flash, like a lot of people do, just use Chrome. It's the best way to do it.
Okay. So just download Chrome.
Yep.
Okay.
I would suggest that you are going to be happier overall.
Great.
Thanks for the call, Ted.
Okay, thank you. Bye now.
And now we're going to move on to Jim. Hello, Jim. How are you?
I'm doing good. Yourself?
Not bad.
Hey, you guys mentioned a VPN earlier, okay, to prevent Comcast from downloading your privacy information. But you still need Comcast to get that VPN, though, don't you?
Right, but the way that the VPNs work is that they encrypt all of your traffic so that they can't be inspected from the point of origin.
Okay, and then another quick question. I live in the county. I'm using Comcast now. I heard you guys kind of laugh at CenturyLink. Do I have any other options?
And as far as high speed is concerned,
yes.
Not really.
The reason why we were laughing at CenturyLink is because of the speed. It's the difference is like night and day.
I know they say call us for 14 gigabytes, you know, which is real low.
Well, 14 megabyte is very slow. And the reason that is a joke is because Comcast will point to CenturyLink and say, look, there's competition out here. And there's not. Yeah. Right, because there is no contest when it comes to high-speed internet. You either have cable in the general area that we're in here, or you don't have high-speed internet.
Right.
So
has anyone ever tried to sue to get someone else to come in besides Comcast?
All the time.
Yeah, that's sort of an ongoing battle. There is a the county has an agreement with Cox and Comcast that says where they can operate and where they cannot.
Correct.
And I think they need to open that up.
Both of those guys are currently in a pitched battle to keep Google Fiber out of every city in America.
Because Google Fiber is a real competitor.
I mean, but this has been going on for easily 10 years when they first went in and said, you know, basically Comcast in the county and the other one in the city. So has no progress been made?
Not really. Because when it used to be Tucson Cable, when it was a municipality cable, before Cox bought the rights to that, Tucson Cable had a 99-year contract to say that they were the only provider in the city limits. And so they're basically trying to fight to nullify a contract.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, in my opinion, terrible. So what we really need to do is have the state step in and say, you can't do that.
Yeah.
And I don't know how much chance we have of that happening.
Has anyone gone to the state or anything? Legislature or anything?
Not that I can't name them. I know I've heard of those types of things, but I don't know that, you know, any of the details on that. I've just heard people have tried it and have failed.
Google is actively fighting it right now, though, and I think they probably have the best chance of making some headway.
Okay. Sounds good, guys. Appreciate it. Thanks for your show.
Speaking of Google Fiber, you know, you know, Google does a lot of things where they don't necessarily make any money. Right, you look at YouTube. YouTube does not make money.
It's actually been an ongoing problem with YouTube.
Right, it operates at a loss every year, and even though they're giving out a bunch of money to creators, it's one of those things where people are like, well, look how rich they are, and like the RIAA going crazy about, well, YouTube makes so much money that YouTube does not make any money. The infrastructure behind it, and that's also why there's no competition really. There's no real legitimate competition for YouTube.
Because only Google can operate it at a loss every year.
Right. So unless Nintendo decided to put out their own video streaming platform, nobody can afford the amount of money it takes to just operate the site YouTube. But also fiber. All right. Interestingly enough is that they're spending a ton of money fighting all of these contract disputes, the infrastructure layout. And the interesting thing about Google Fiber is that they're offering gigabit, 1,000 megabit speed, basically.
It makes the other providers look like CenturyLink.
Right. So it's so much faster than everything else. They're charging, $100 a month, or about that $80 a month for one of their plans, and like $115 if you want TV to go with it, or something like that. I think it's about $115. They have actually managed to operate without a whole lot of profit, but while still doing that, while doing the build out and having legal battles with all of the municipalities that they're moving into, and still manage to not operate at a loss. To think about how much Comcast and Cox and even CenturyLink to a certain extent are screwing you by saying we have to charge these ridiculous amounts for teeny tiny amounts of bandwidth because we can't afford it is obviously a lie.
Yeah, and I mean, that's the reason why they're so scared of fiber, is because it literally proves that that is not the case.
It's craziness.
And I mean, if fiber wins, it's going to be much like today. There's not going to be any competition, but it's not going to be for the same reasons.
Yeah, so I think there always will be, right? At some point, it's going to reach this like critical mass where Comcast and Cox and everybody will have to just admit that they've been screwing you for the last 15 years when it comes to internet access, and that what they really need to do is compete head on with a real competitor. And suddenly we're going to have much, much faster internet at better prices. The caps will be gone. Snooping will be gone on deep packet inspection. All of that stuff where they've managed to build an infrastructure of lies will all fall apart.
And, I mean, data caps especially are just an outright lie. There is no need for it.
Right. They're trying to tell you that you need to be limited. You need to not use all of your bandwidth so that you know, you can have a better user experience. What?
They're relying solely on the fact that maybe 1% of the population actually understands what they're talking about, and those people aren't loud enough to say that's not true.
Well, I mean, even when the whole Comcast, you know, people trying to leave Comcast recordings made it out in the world, went completely viral, got mainstream media coverage, Comcast didn't change anything. They just don't care. And I think that there needs to be a certain amount of... I operate a business, and I operate this business on the idea that I built it on the idea that I care about people, right? I care about why I do this, because I care about the people that I help, and that I care that other people don't. I care that there are other companies out there that do terrible, terrible jobs at doing their job and make all of us look bad. And I think that when you point out the fact that there are others out there that just don't care, right? That needs to be the thing that, as consumers, that we are interested in and interested in highlighting and saying, you know what we need? We need a company that cares. And who knows whether or not Google cares, right? But obviously they're doing something when it comes to Google Fiber. That is that they're going into places that are monopolized, that have no other choice. They start with the low-income areas and offer free internet for life, basically, as long as you pay the setup fee. Hey, come on. I mean, that's got to show some degree of care about the people involved.
Especially considering that all they needed to do to beat the current ISPs was just double the speed they offer. But they, you know, tenfold beat it. More than that.
Right, and for half the cost in most cases. And it's like, if you were to take the dollar per megabit that you pay now, I mean, you've got the high-speed package at home, Tara.
Yeah, I do.
All right, so how much does that cost you?
$150 a month.
All right, so for about half of that, all right, you could have three times the speed that you're paying for now.
That'd be
and
nice.
And no data caps.
Yeah,
all right, so nice. I mean, it's that kind of thing. It's really, I don't know. It's just, I find the whole thing to be irritating. Because, you know, the truth is like my internet bill is insane, right? For the two offices
mm-hmm.
and the third one, right? The offsite one.
Right.
All three of those locations, I think that my monthly internet bill is $1,200. You know, and it's just to support the infrastructure that we have, support the websites, the email hosting, all the stuff. And I don't have a choice. There's nobody I can turn to and be like, I wish I could get a better price on this.
And those are business rates, you know? So if you had one Google Fiber connection and could somehow split it among the three locations,
right,
it would be a tenth of the price and still better in terms of speed.
Right. Even if a cumulative speed, right? If I were to add the speed of all three locations, it still would not be gigabit, and it would be one-tenth the cost. So I think that we should, you know, because Google Fiber listens to the where is the interest. And we tried pushing this a few years ago when Google was saying, hey, we're going to start looking at other cities to move into. They already expressed an interest in Tucson once, and it got shut down.
Unfortunately, Tucson is not really the capital of technology innovation.
It should be.
And they're not super friendly to businesses like Tesla and Google.
We lost the Gigafactory.
What we need to do is we need to make sure that we express an interest and then apply some pressure to our local legislators. And this is if you're anywhere, right? It doesn't matter if you're local to where this show is recorded or if you're anywhere in the United States. You should be applying pressure to your local, you know, legislators and saying, we're tired of the monopoly that exists when it comes to high-speed internet. Because 90% of the United States only has one high-speed provider in the area.
And when I do a speed test and, you know, my 120 megabit connection, it says I'm in the 1% for internet mm-hmm. speed in the United States. That's sad. That's terrible.
It certainly is. We're going to take a quick break, and then we're going to come back for phone calls at 790-2040. We'll be right back. I thought about you while the radio played.
Computer troubles? Need some advice? Call in now. Mike Swanson will be back after these messages. The Computer Guru Show, AM 1030, KBOY, The Voice.
I'm nerdy in the extreme and whiter than sour cream. I was in AV club and glee club and even the chess team. Only question I ever thought was hard. What do I like, Kirk, or do I like Picard? Spend every weekend at the Renaissance Fair. Got my name on my underwear.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show, 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. Let's go through some calls here. Ted's back. You still having a problem, Ted?
Still having a problem. What the error message is saying is failed to cache the download installer. And then it gave you the code.
Okay. So every once in a while we do this thing called the freebie of the week. And that's going to be you this week, Ted. So I want you to call the office, 304-8300.
Oh, wait a minute. Let me write that down. 340-E100.
No, 304-8300. Oh.
304-8300.
Right. You call down there. You tell them that Mike said that you're the freebie of the week. And they will take a look at it and see if they can get it straightened out for you.
Okay.
And it'll cost you nothing.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thanks for the call, Ted.
Bye now.
Well, let's go ahead and talk to Tom. Hello, Tom. How are you?
Hey, Gurus. How are you today?
Oh, we're doing great.
Good. I really enjoyed your two-hour format. Is that going to continue into the foreseeable future?
I don't know. How much money you got? Yeah, we're going to keep doing the two-hour show.
We can't go back now.
I really appreciate that. Thanks very much. Right. Okay?
The whole problem was that we couldn't get through enough content in an hour. It just went by way too quickly. So, yeah, the two-hour show is much more comfortable for me. I like it.
And I appreciate what you're doing. Thanks very much.
Thanks for the call, Tom. Although, you know, you can go to Patreon, Tom, and, you know, help us afford the second hour that we pay for. That's always an option. Patreon.com/guru show.
Or guruShow.com/Patreon.
Yeah, it works in both directions. It's palindromic. Let's go ahead and talk to Mark. Hello, Mark. How are you?
Pretty good. I just got to remember to write my name in my underwear, so I'll be more official.
That's right.
Then, anyway, so, yeah, again, thanks for your great show, and I also like your two-hour format. But wondering if you know any striking advantages or differences between the new Note 7 and the Galaxy.
I'm going to hand this over to Rob because Rob is the mobile phone dude.
Well, were you going to say the new Galaxy phone or specifically just the S7, the one that's already out?
Well, whatever the S7, whatever. So I'm debating between the Note 7 and whatever the next,
It really depends on whether or not you care about tech specs specifically or just the overall, feel of the phone.
Well, let's start with tech specs.
In terms of tech specs, it is better than what's out right now. I don't want to go too far into it because we're limited on time here.
Right.
But you can go to gsmarena.com, and you can literally compare the two phones side by side. It's got a better resolution specifically because the Note phones always have a bigger screen.
They have nicer monitors too, or screens.
Yeah, they're definitely higher quality.
What are you talking about?
I could be wrong, but I also believe that the Note 7 has a bigger battery. So, to drive that big old screen.
Okay.
But you'll really want to just go look at the two specs side by side. If all you care about is the overall feel of the phone, just go with whichever one you like.
Well, here's my position. I don't have one. I just have the old Star Trek phone. So everything is, totally new.
If you're considering switching over to a Samsung phone right now, get the Note 7.
I'm thinking.
It's definitely worth it. And also some really nifty Samsung gadgets are coming out specifically for the Note 7.
Okay.
Now, my personal opinion on the matter is that I don't like the Samsung interface, right? And that's a personal thing. It's just
the TouchWiz interface.
Yeah, I don't like it. I don't like the way that they operate. All right, I like the vanilla Android, and or even the Moto Blur interface is, I think, better than Samsung interface.
That's a legitimate concern.
So.
Yeah,
that's my personal opinion is that I would rather get a Motorola phone than a Samsung phone.
Or get the Samsung phone, root it, and put CyanogenMod on there.
Yeah, you could also go Cyanogen. Cyanogen is if you root any Android phone, you can go Cyanogen and you can make it anything you want.
So how durable is this?
Well, the one downside of Samsung phones, in my opinion, is that they are very delicate little flowers.
Yeah, and, you got to be careful.
Yeah, so get an OtterBox case for it and call it a day.
Mess up with the edge?
I'm sure they make one specifically for it.
OtterBox makes one specifically for that. Also, there's another soft case that does really well with that. But they are delicate. I've broken two of them in 6 months.
I don't. So you know. I don't often recommend extended warranties, but buy the protection plan for your Samsung phone.
All right, we gotta move right along, Mark. Thanks for the call. Let's go ahead and talk to Bruce. Hello, Bruce. How are you?
Hi. Good morning. I'm fine. Thanks for asking. My wife has a Mac cloud browser on her computer, and we're thinking of taking it off. And will it have any effect on the other computer if we do, or on this computer?
I'm sorry. What?
She's got what kind of browser?
It's a Maxton cloud browser. I have never even heard of it.
Okay.
And it's a Maxton cloud browser.
Oh, we talked about this once before, and I think our conclusion was don't do that.
Yes. Don't take it off?
No, don't use it.
Don't use it. Right.
Yeah, okay, so I remember go ahead and get in there and uninstall and get rid of it.
Pretty much the rule of thumb with browsers is if like we haven't heard of it, don't.
Yeah, I think that. So you're asking if you take it off of there, how's that going to affect the other users?
No, affect our use of this computer. I just want to make sure that all of a sudden you take that off and it's not working.
If you install like Chrome, for instance, in most cases it'll let you import all of your bookmarks and saved settings and things like that.
Yeah, but it only does that from well-known browsers. I don't know if it'll do it from that one.
Yeah, I'm wondering if it will or not.
Well, it just keeps popping up and asking if we want to be the default. If it wants to be the default, then we always tell it no, and we're waiting to hear from you. So.
Oh, yeah. So switch over to Chrome, or because we recommend Chrome, make Chrome the default, and then you won't have to deal with that. And then you can uninstall that other browser.
Okay, and then we can uninstall. Okay.
Yeah, that's my plan. That's what I would do.
Okay, thank you. You guys have a good weekend. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for the call, Bruce. All right, so we got a minute to wrap up here.
I wanted to say real quick about that other browser thing. Mm-hmm. I'm not necessarily saying that any other browser besides Chrome is bad, but that Chrome is the most supported browser right now, so you have the best chance of being safe if you use one of the major browsers.
There you are. All right, you have the opportunity to support this show to help us pay for our second hour and keep us coming back every week just because it's better to make no money than to lose a bunch of money. So go ahead and go to patreon.com/guruShow or guruShow.com/Patreon and help us keep the lights on. You can also visit our locations at 64 North Harrison or 510 East Fort Lowell. We're here to help you out with all of your technology issues. It's what we do. So thanks for listening, and we will see you next week. I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Computer Guru Show. If you did, please consider sharing it with your friends and subscribing to this channel if you haven't already. Your subscription helps us reach new audiences and expand the show in new directions. Please also consider supporting us on Patreon. For as little as a dollar a month, you can help the Computer Guru Show expand into a longer format, as well as support the production of new content for this channel. Links are in the description below, and thank you again. We'll see you next week.